What if the foundation of modern medicine was laid not on cadavers, but on the living bodies of the condemned? In the 3rd century BCE, under the rule of the Ptolemies in Hellenistic Egypt, the city of Alexandria became a hub of anatomical research and ethical transgression. Greek physicians Herophilos and Erasistratus, both famed in antiquity for their medical knowledge, conducted experiments that, even by ancient standards, were deeply unsettling. According to multiple historical sources, including the Roman encyclopedist Celsus, these physicians were permitted by the Ptolemaic kings to perform vivisections, the dissection of living human beings. The subjects were typically condemned criminals, offered not mercy, but the fate of becoming living specimens for anatomical discovery. To cut open the living is more profitable than the dead, Herophilos is reported to have argued, believing that only through direct observation of living organs could one understand their functions. They meticulously documented the circulatory, nervous, and digestive systems, distinguishing veins from arteries and even identifying parts of the brain such as the cerebellum. Herophilos is often called the father of anatomy for these achievements. Yet these achievements came at a harrowing cost. The moral boundary between knowledge and cruelty, so often fragile in ancient medicine, was blurred beyond recognition. Chinese Emperor's Elixir of Immortality, Death by Mercury. Qin Shi Huang, the first emperor of a unified China, ruled from 221 to 210 BCE. His legacy is immortal. The Great Wall's foundation, the terracotta army guarding his tomb, and the dream that consumed him, eternal life. Obsessed with immortality, he turned to court alchemists who promised longevity through mystical elixirs. Their key ingredient? Mercury. Historical accounts, including those from the records of the grand historian, Shiji, state that the emperor regularly ingested concoctions laced with mercury, believing them to grant divine endurance. Ironically, these very potions may have hastened his death. His vast mausoleum, still unexcavated, is said to contain flowing rivers of mercury, a belief confirmed by modern soil analysis, which detected unusually high mercury concentrations near the tomb mound. Texts like the Bao Puzi, written in the 4th century CE by the scholar Ge Hong, instructed followers on ingesting alchemical substances to achieve transcendence. Yet, instead of enlightenment, these rituals often led to poisoning, causing illness and death among emperors, nobles, and seekers of immortality. What began as a spiritual journey toward eternal life became time and again a fatal illusion. Proof that in some ages, the greatest danger came not from enemies, but from medicine itself. Ancient skull drilling, trepanation across cultures. Imagine standing in a world with no anesthesia, no antiseptics, and yet someone carefully drills a hole into your skull and you survive. This was not a scene from madness, but a real medical practice known as trepanation, performed by civilizations across the globe for over 9,000 years. From the mountains of ancient Peru to the battlefields of classical Greece, trepanation wasn't just a desperate ritual. It was a remarkable leap in early surgical knowledge. In the Andean world, trepanation reached astonishing levels of refinement. Archaeologists have uncovered skulls with clean circular openings and signs of bone regeneration, meaning patients lived long after the operation. Some individuals even survived multiple procedures, suggesting this was more than guesswork, it was practiced expertise. Meanwhile, in ancient Greece, the physician Hippocrates described trepanation as a treatment for head trauma in his 5th century BCE work on injuries of the head. Even then, the goal was precise: to relieve pressure, remove shattered bone, or treat swelling caused by blows in war. Across cultures, tools ranged from obsidian blades to bronze saws, each designed to avoid piercing the brain itself. While we can only speculate how they managed pain, perhaps with alcohol or medicinal herbs, their ability to perform such invasive procedures with measured intent is extraordinary. Medicinal cannibalism, how Europeans turned Egyptian mummies into medicine. What if the cure for your headache was a powdered corpse from ancient Egypt? Between the 12th and 17th centuries, Europe was gripped by a disturbing yet socially accepted trend, medicinal cannibalism. Physicians, nobles, and even royalty consumed mumia, a substance made from ground-up Egyptian mummies, believing it could treat everything from internal bleeding to plague. The dried flesh, soaked in resins, was thought to carry powerful healing properties preserved over centuries. Imported from Egypt and sold by apothecaries, genuine mummy remains were crushed into powders, mixed into tinctures, or added to oils. While many users believed they were tapping into ancient wisdom, in reality, this was a practice driven by misinformation, fueled by misread translations, and a fascination with the mystical East. Ironically, the ancient Egyptians, who had developed complex embalming rituals to honor the dead, never intended for their mummies to become early modern pharmaceuticals. Ancient cataract surgery, stabbing eyes with bronze needles. Would you let someone stab your eye if it meant you might see again? Over 2,000 years ago, long before modern ophthalmology, physicians in ancient India and Rome attempted to restore vision using a method known as couching. This procedure, described in the Sushruta Samhita around 600 BCE, one of the world's earliest surgical texts, involved using a sharp instrument to dislodge the clouded lens of the eye, pushing it downward and out of the visual axis. Surprisingly, the method spread across civilizations. Aulus Cornelius Celsus, a Roman medical writer from the 1st century CE, detailed a similar technique using bronze or copper needles, carefully inserted at the side of the eye. While incredibly risky, couching was sometimes successful, restoring partial vision to patients with cataracts, even if the clarity was far from perfect. There was no antiseptic, no anesthesia, and no real understanding of infection. Yet these early surgeons displayed remarkable skill and boldness, attempting what many thought impossible, to bring sight back to the blind. Some patients likely improved, while others faced complications. But for the ancient world, couching was a glimpse into the future of surgical innovation. Inca skull binding, warping babies' heads for status. In the ancient Andes, from as early as 1000 BCE through the height of the Inca Empire, cultures practiced cranial deformation, the intentional reshaping of infants' skulls. Using tight wrappings, wooden boards, or padded braces, parents would mold their children's heads into elongated or flattened forms, beginning just weeks after birth, when the skull was still soft and malleable. This wasn't done for beauty alone. In societies like the Paracas and later the Inca, head shape carried deep social meaning, signifying nobility, tribal affiliation, or even a connection to the divine. Spanish chroniclers such as Garcilaso de la Vega, himself of mixed Inca and Spanish heritage, recorded that these modified skulls were often seen among elites and priestly classes. Archaeologists have unearthed hundreds of elongated skulls from burial sites on the Paracas Peninsula, many remarkably symmetrical, indicating careful and deliberate shaping. Far from being seen as harmful, the process was likely a ritual of identity, tying individuals to their community, ancestors, and cosmic order. Across centuries and continents, humanity's quest for healing and understanding has often walked a razor's edge between discovery and cruelty. These practices, drawn from medicine's ancient roots, reveal a truth both haunting and profound. The path to knowledge has sometimes demanded unthinkable costs. History does not simply record these acts. It reminds us of what civilizations will risk in pursuit of power, immortality, or identity. What do these ancient methods reveal about how different cultures understood the body and the soul? Comment below and share your perspective. As the Roman philosopher Cicero once reflected, the diseases of the soul are more dangerous and more numerous than those of the body.